We're here tonight to talk about the Ticehurst neighbourhood plan, and this is a summary of 2 days' work plus the work we did in January. And I'll introduce myself. I'm Richard Eastham. I'm an urban planner, urban designer, and I've done a lot of work with rural settlements and villages. And I'm here with my team, who is Antonia, who's at the back. He's been with us the last 2 days, and Sophie as well. And we work as a small team helping working with parish councils around the country. So we're here at the invitation of Ticehurst Parish Council to help them prepare their neighbourhood plan. We're not from this part of the world, we're from Bournemouth, so we're sort of outsiders, independent brokers in this, and we've been brought in to help with this project. So that's who we are. And what you're about to see is the work of the last 48 hours, okay? So. The slideshow is going to be sketchy, it's going to be probably errors in it, but we're going to be as accurate as we can be, and it's not by no means certain and final. And it's a really important message to say at the beginning that all the work you see and all the ideas are ideas, and we're trying to move towards a neighbourhood plan, but these are initial ideas that are building to something, so nothing is certain here, and if there are any errors, it's because we've been working flat out since yesterday morning. So for over the last 2 days, we had a series of structured sessions. We've heard from everyone that's come into the room and listened to their views and got a record of it. We've been trying to grow this common ground. There's lots of different points of view. We've heard about the independent Republic of Flimwell and how it's going to go over the border to Hawkhurst, and Kent is just up there as well. You're most definitely East Sussex though, am I right? Yeah, absolutely, so get that right. We've been drawing as well as writing and talking, so there's been a lot of production work going on, and we've increased the knowledge, the sort of shared knowledge of the village and the parish. And we've had these 9 sessions, of which you are in the last one, the final session tonight on the Thursday evening. So we've worked our way through methodically, building more information each time and adding to the sort of knowledge base. And what you've got at the end of this is a really good platform for the next stages of getting your neighbourhood plan developed. So this is the parish, you know it well. This is the sort of unusual shape you have in a way. You've got Buell Water at the top. Not all of it is yours. There's a boundary line that goes through the middle. International Waters, it might be known. And you've got Ticehurst, the village, the larger of the 3 settlements, sitting sort of in the middle. And which is where we are tonight. We've got Stonegate down with its station, but some distance from the railway line. It's about 1 kilometre away at least. And Flimwell over on that peripheral edge. So an amazing landscape as well, which we'll talk about shortly, that you know, it's a black and white drawing here to give the context, but there's a lot more going on underneath and on top of that. So that's the landscape, this aerial photography that we've had pinned up at the back, which we're constantly dipping in and out of, the woodland, the field patterns, the boundaries. It's a real rich history of landscape development. All of it influenced by human activity over hundreds, thousands of years. You know, the idea that all of this is somehow natural, it's an evolved landscape from all the activities that have gone on. And the AONB office, the Area of Outstanding Natural Beauty, their headquarters office is in Flimwell, and they've kindly provided us with a lot of maps on this, which is at the back of the room, and we've been using that as a resource throughout the last 2 days. So the neighbourhood planning, where does it come from? What is it? Well, in 2011, the coalition government, as it then was, introduced the Localism Act. It was about planning for growth and change and development across towns and villages, and also the National Planning Policy Framework. And that set the scene for the first time that parish and town councils could create a legally binding plan. And the National Planning Policy Framework says this about neighbourhood planning. It gives communities direct power to develop a shared vision for their neighbourhood and deliver the sustainable development they need. I've underlined the shared vision because that's an important part of what the last 48 hours has been about, trying to build that common ground so that the vision is genuinely shared across the whole parish. Deliver sustainable development. It is about building, it is about development. It's not just housing, but it's about growth and change and planning for that and anticipating that. And not all of that's easy. There's some tough choices and people are very uneasy about that, and we'll perhaps find out why. But that's the crux of what neighbourhood planning is about, and it has to come from the parish level. So it's the first time that below a town or borough council, a district or borough council, that you can create these plans. And it's very new. There's only 100 of them across the country, but there's about 1,000 in preparation, of which one is yours. And what can they do? Well, they can set policies to determine planning applications. So in future, any planning application in Ticehurst Parish, the first document the planners will pick up will be your neighbourhood plan. What does it say about this site? You can, if you wish, grant planning permission directly through your neighbourhood plan, through a local development order. You can set out what's needed so the developers can work directly with you rather than through Rother District Council. Plan positively. If you wish, you can ask or develop and plan for more housing than is in the local development plan. That's not necessarily applicable here, but certain parts of the country, they're actually getting more affordable housing than they've been given by their borough or district through their neighbourhood plan. So that power is there if you want to use it. And finally, and very importantly, you can set out the quality of development. And one of the things that we found working around the country is many people are sort of anxious about development because we've built some really crap stuff over the last 50 years in Britain. And when you see what we've built, everyone would be anxious about that at the bottom of the field or so on. But the more you talk to them, the more they're very enthusiastic and passionate about the good development and the great architecture that they find in their villages. So if you get the quality right in the right location, people aren't NIMBY, they're sort of not in my backyard bad development, they're anti-bad development rather than just development full stop. So quality, if you get the quality right, it's a really important point. And we had some quotes to begin yesterday. Make no small plans, they have no magic to stir men's blood. So we want a bold and ambitious plan for Ticehurst Parish, for the whole area. And this is from Chicago over 100 years ago. So all the skyscraper plans we've had over the last 2 days, we've scrapped, we're not doing that. But I think the message is important that if you want to enthuse people and get them involved in the places where they live, and we've got a full house tonight, which is great, it's got to be a plan that gets people excited and passionate about it. So we're trying to be bold, but not reckless. And this quote is from the chief planner at the time the coalition introduced neighbourhood planning, and he used this quote at a conference I was at. He said, "Those communities that want to plan for themselves, go out there and be bold. Don't be reckless, though." And I think tonight, hopefully we've got the balance right between really cautious about your sensitive landscape, but bold plans as well. So how do plans fit together? Well, this is a device we've used to try and structure our thoughts these last 2 days. We've looked at uses and activities, where people live, where they go to school, and we have the school kids in, we'll see them in a minute, where they work, and then also how you travel between them, access and movement, the links between these places. The quality of those places, the green spaces, the streets, the village green, the square, and finally, as you come around in the sort of clockwise direction, the form and the detail of a place, the architecture, the scale, the materials. And when those four components work well, you get a terrific sense of place. People say places lack that, they're soulless, or they don't have that quality. Well, and they can't really put their finger on why a place has a sense of place. Well, our argument is when those four things work well, you get it. And what has happened, unfortunately, in recent years, is that up here, the town planners have done that bit. And here we've had the highway engineers, and down here the landscape architect, and finally the architect. They've never talked to each other. They've never been in the same room. Their plans have been done in isolation of one another, and things fall apart. So you'll have a big road from the highway engineers that doesn't relate to where people want to go or where they live. The architects will put in a sort of an unusual building in the wrong place, badly designed, and everything sort of falls apart. So your neighbourhood plan has to have an eye on all four components all the time and make it work. And here's a few little examples of where it goes wrong. This is uses and activity. And this is any town in Britain over the last 50 years. You've got a lot of houses on cul-de-sacs here. Big box retail, this could be a retail park. Offices down the cul-de-sac and maybe a supermarket here. So anyone who lives in this area here, they're going to queue in the morning to come out here in their cars because there's only one way in and one way out. All those houses have just two connections. And that's where you get the traffic jams and the gridlock, and these junctions get made bigger and bigger to accommodate it. Meanwhile, here's the school or the supermarket. It's one way in, one way out. And if a child lived there, they've got to go all the way around to meet their friends, and there's poor connections, poor quality, and you get a lot of gaps in between. And this is how we've been developing towns and cities recently. Fragmented, disconnected, and poor connections between residential areas and where people want to be. This is what we've done historically, and you find it in Ticehurst, right in the middle, and there's Stonegate and Flimwell in it to varying degrees, but a crossroads where you've got mix of uses around the middle, the square, shops and other things, a series of connected lanes and grids that bring people closer to where they need to be. And we've forgotten how to do it, really, but this, you can find this in villages and towns, and these well-connected spaces and putting the denser parts around the crossroads is what you get. And villages in the very heart are quite dense, actually. Your heart of your conservation area in Ticehurst has a lot of density and an edge to the countryside that's lower density. So that's what we need to aim for and avoid the mistakes of the past. Here's another great mistake. Welcome Home. This has just recently been built in Northampton, and this is a car park for the people that live there. And the expectation was that they'd park their car and walk all the way around to the front door. Well, it took about 2 weeks before someone cut into the fence a gate, and now their back door is their front door, and their front door is no longer used, and everything's the wrong way around, and that's what planners and highway engineers end up with when they don't communicate. And this is a sort of risk that we have, and why people don't want new development, because they expect the worst. But there's much better ways of getting the car parked in country environments, rural villages. This is just around the corner from the previous photo in Northampton. Lovely little courtyard, gravel surface, garages tucked away, a tree just in that corner there. Fantastic. Secure, safe, sensitive, and very much a rural approach. So we need to learn from that. The streets and the spaces, the landscape architect. Someone paid and designed for this. So are we going to win the World Cup? Of course we're not. Not with no ball games. You know, we've got a lot of gold medals on the track in the cycling. But where's the next cyclist going to come from? Lovely bit of green space. No ball games. Who's that for? And here's the bench over there. It's got no handrails. It's got no back. Elderly people need to get in and out and stand up. And so a bench that's not that useful and a beautiful place that's not meant to be played in. And again, that's been built in the last few years. So quality of spaces really matters, and we need to think about who it's for. Kids want to play out, and older people like watching kids play out. So it's a great mix, so it's a real shame that this sort of thing happens. We've seen signs like that around Ticehurst as well, but this is actually in Gloucestershire. Streets and spaces, this is a lovely little street. It's got drainage, it's down the middle, which is a lovely way of doing it, with little sets. It's got no yellow lines, it's got no white lines, it's one way or two way, it's not quite sure, the cars go around very slowly. It's got a lovely little edge to it here to define the property. It's a little setback. This is in the Cotswolds in Marshfield. This was built in the last 15 years. And we can do it when we try and we understand how it works. So here you've got the highway engineer really working well with the architect to create a very positive village environment. So it can be done. Form and detail, architects and the detail of buildings. You know, this is a very old-fashioned bookshop. I think it's in Bristol, this. It's lots of interest and variety, and you know, shop fronts can really add quality to a village and what, you know, and how you see into the life of a business. But this is quite old-fashioned. This is a more modern take on the shop front. I really like this. This is in Madrid in Spain. There's a door for the kids to go into this toy shop. So the children see their own door and think, fantastic, they're in the shop in a flash. Mum and dad have got to follow, and bingo, you're in the toy shop buying something. But I think this image captures the fact that we've got a design for younger people as well. And it might be some play areas or just getting them involved as the plan moves forward. But remember the two doors, and it's up for the current generation, but the future generation as well. So, form and detail as well. This is, we're now going from Spain to Holland. This is Rotterdam. And this is a message about what makes things personal and special. This is a very bold architect-led scheme. It's the Dutch, you know, they like this sort of thing. North-facing, lots of light through this. Is it a factory unit? No, it's a residential scheme. This is people's front doors, okay? Everyone got a front door like this. It's got no door handles. You've got to press this secret James Bond catch on it. And this, everyone will live like this. And it took a few weeks before this one resident decided, no, this is my house, you know? They've got a bench outside, they've got a number and a doorbell. They've even taken up a flagstone there to plant a bit of a climber. So do not underestimate the wish for people to personalise their properties. People are very proud about where they live, and the neighbourhood plan needs to create room for this sort of evolution, and it's not one big idea, it's got to grow over time. So that's a quick example of these four components and why they matter and how they can apply. We've been to Holland and Spain and Bristol, but it's about Ticehurst from now on. So there we are. And back in January, this process began. We were in this room and we had a very busy session looking at places and what makes them special. And this plan, which is on the board just over there, emerged from this. And the colours on this are looking at planning, landscape, architecture, conservation and engineering. And this has been a sort of really good record about the positives, the opportunities, the constraints, and all the issues that Ticehurst as a settlement has. And we've got views out to countryside that need protecting, this green edge between them and Flimwell and so on. And there's a lot of information there that's on record now. And Ticehurst, we also asked them some questions about what makes them special. These are the qualities that came out the top: friendly, safe, and attractive. That's what Ticehurst people felt defined them best. Green and distinctive. They consider themselves charming as well. Came in at number 6. And a fun place. So this top 10 is an average of what everyone told us back in January. We had a lot of information from those events. We also asked them in Ticehurst, what are your big challenges? Housing growth, health service, traffic, and broadband were the things that they felt needed addressing. So in a way, what we've been asking is, what things should your plan protect, those qualities, and what things should your plan address, which are the challenges? Also in January, we went to Flimwell at the Woodland Enterprise Centre. We ran the similar sort of event here, the fantastic grid shell roof that we had. And here's Steve Johnson talking about the redevelopment, and we'll come on to that. Same again, we had a really good plan that captured everything about Flimwell. The blue blobs here were potential bits of housing that you could fit in. You've got these great architectural merits around here, and the church down there as well. And the crossroads, which is very busy and very difficult, the A21 running through here. So these are the challenges for Flimwell that we got down. And when we asked Flimwell about what makes them special, they said the AONB, they're right at the heart of this. The headquarters is there. They felt that was really important to them. Green and friendly, distinctive, enterprising. And they consider themselves quite sporty as well in Flimwell. I think they're surrounded by woodland. They've got activity centres and the golf course and others. So they had that quality. Traffic, they're number one. The A21 clearly is an issue. Housing growth, pedestrian access to the school from where they are, walking down the hill is a real challenge. So again, we got the 10 big challenges for Flimwell down as well. And Stonegate was a third, but not the final, the one that we did at the end in January. We ran the same exercise there, and this was a great image of how they were really looking at the detail of around Stonegate and how it works. And this plan emerged as well, with important recreational land here and green edges, the allotments, and you've got here the green spaces around the church, and people were suggesting bits of housing could be accommodated sensitively around Stonegate. And we've been interrogated on this the last 2 days, and we've modified and challenged and looked at it again. And we'll come on to how we've sort of ended up at the end of these 2 days. But this plan as well includes this lovely corner as you come around the T-junction, Cottenden, as you head in. And that Stonegate settlement is a very different situation, as it were, to other places. So Stonegate, they're friendly as well. But they're unique. They're uniquely friendly, and they're safe, and they're attractive as well, and they're clean in Stonegate. So a friendly, clean bunch, but brilliantly, they're independent as well, number 6. They see themselves a little bit apart, and we found that the inventor of the stomach pump was born in Stonegate. So maybe the clean and healthy bit, I don't know, it's got no pub. But we found out little quirky facts about this, and I think the whole parish has got quirky facts emerging all the time. So Stonegate, broadband was an issue, but the second one here, sense of community. They told us when the shop went, a lot of that community disappeared with the shop. It was a neutral ground where people met. There's a farmer's market that occasionally pops up, which really helps. But some sort of way of binding that together would be really useful, they said. So we've got their top 10 as well. And all of that is in the visioning report. This is on the website now. It's quite a lengthy document, 40 pages plus. We asked more questions about all those settlements as well that are in there. So that's a quick summary of it. And that led us to yesterday morning when we had a series of presentations from people that's pinned up back there on the board at the back, there, hanging on the bulldog clips. And Steve kicked off with his presentation about being environmentally friendly, quirky and interesting, promoting self-build and affordable housing is a key message. Being bold, spreading development evenly, cycle pedestrian access and tourism. This was a key thing from Steve, not enough is done. Ecotourism is important, we've got a great landscape, great places to stay and eat, and energy neutral, so we've got these links to Buell Water. So we'll whiz through these because we had a series of really good presentations, and Steve kicked off with a really strong one about the environment, followed quickly by another Steve. Steve Johnson's promoting the redevelopment of the bird park at Flimwell and use of local timber. There's 14 amazing ponds over there, getting in artists and craftspeople into the area. This project's got planning permission now. He's actively pursuing this. Self-sustaining workshops, student housing, using the high wheel to grow fauna and flora, energy centre, and an architecture that competes with the trees. It's a very woodland, it's a fantastic innovation going on there. Woodland Enterprise Centre's just across the road. 50-acre woodland, design and making centre. University College London wants to invest here. He's hoping to get that done, a partnership. And that will really have a focal space at Flimwell. So that was his link to that. So we'll come on to how that would fit. The primary school came along with the deputy head, I think it was, and they did a terrific presentation. Things we like, shops with easy access, the church, linked with schools, restaurants, the things they want, access to London and Hastings, of all places, is important to them. Play facilities, challenges, litter and dog mess. They walk to school, they hate the dog poo, the graffiti, better paths, difficult to cross. Some of your paths are shocking, you know, virtually unwalkable in places. Not many areas to get jobs. They're already thinking about their careers. There are only eight, you know. People and places, lack of things to do for teenagers. Maybe that's a bit more imminent for them. Question. We asked them some questions at the end. What sort of shops would you like? They wanted a sports shop so they could buy new trainers or something, or footballs. But they were terrific. And they sat through. You can see them on the front row there, very, really quietly trying to eat biscuits while Glynis did her presentation. And Glynis had done some great research between January and yesterday, where she'd gone out and asked families that hadn't been involved up until now their issues about community atmosphere, open spaces, young adults who want to stay in the village, no more footballers' wives' houses. That's what was the comment was. Children don't feel safe with the current road traffic conditions. They want their own spaces, bigger houses, access to more affordable shops as well. And the village square should be more of a focal point. And that was an issue that's come up again. Clarwyn Hughes with a great presentation about environment and ecology and accessibility to the countryside, valuing village spaces and connectivity, respecting form and pattern of the countryside. This goes back to the AONB work, promotion of land-based businesses as well, about working, the working village. And Sheena followed on with a great presentation on work as well. It's always been a working village, but in the recent years we're losing. You know, there's a sense that that's being lost. It's becoming a commuter village. How do you win that back? A lot of employment in the area, but it's not widely known. This links to Steve Johnson and his big project at Flimwell. That could be a real counterbalance to the commuter settlement. Lots of commercial business at the moment. You've got Advertex, Gibbs Reed, Wall Crouch, Parsonage Farm. We've seen some of this again today. Quite a lot is hidden, but it is still a working parish. And how can the neighbourhood plan encourage and nurture that and keep it going? Be 200 extra people potentially in new houses. Where are they going to work? What sort of employers are wanted? How do you attract them? We spoke today about the local enterprise partnership in this area. We'll have a database of businesses looking for new premises. That's how your neighbourhood plan can key into the LEP and actually attract and invest, get people to come in. And Chris, who's with us tonight, and he was great. He stayed with us all day yesterday. He's a town planner. He's working on behalf of a house builder. Feel free to boo if you want. But Ryden Homes, to their credit, stood up, presented. They turned up the little team yesterday. They said, we've got land in the village. We want to get it built on. We think we can do this well. And they were here to hear the views. And it was great that we had them in the room. And Chris talked about the requirement for new housing at district, strategic and local levels. Ryden Homes, they've worked across Southeast England. Sites are identified. They have not yet got planning permission. It was refused because of its impact on the AONB. The Singehurst site, which is just out the corner here. Ancient woodland trees and hedges are around that area. Vehicle access, private shared drives, woodland buffer to the south. They think they've got a good scheme. It's not got permission, but they want to try again through the neighbourhood plan. And housing mix, low density, only 16 dwellings, affordable, some of those, 7 of them. You know, this is the sort of thing that we've just heard about that there isn't enough of in the village. And here's a developer getting refused permission by Rother District Council. So there's clearly a tension here. We're not building the houses we need, and they're getting permission refused when they try. So something's not working out. But Chris and his team was great. They stayed with us throughout yesterday and walked around the site. And there's good opportunities from this site to create links to the school. And Rother District Council wanted to see industrial uses on there, or semi-industrial employment. But maybe it's better as a housing site on the edge. So we've looked at that as well. And Liz talked about the square and the historic meeting point. There's a great image there of what it used to be like. Car dominance, we know what it's like. We had a model with us throughout the 2 days. Shared space desired, or a mix, a better balance between pedestrians and cars. And short-term parking, maybe one way is needed. So again, there's no pound signs on this, but it's, you know, it's big money, but it really matters. And we'll talk about maybe why later. Anne, who's lived here many years, talked about farming, because she's a farmer and she knows how it works, and all these lovely developments out on the edge and what's happened, and encouraging ornate lamps. She quite likes that, so we've got detail coming out. And Tony spoke about Buell Water in the A21 and sunken lanes, traditional feature, but they're poorly managed. Restoring and managing that, affordable development, and how we get that in. And Liz finished off this fantastic morning of really intensive presentations on behalf of the community friends. And it was a really good one to finish on, because it wasn't about housing and tiles and traffic and tarmac. It was about people and how they help one another. You've got an aging population like everywhere has in the country, driving people to the hospital and trips and prescriptions and picking things up, and just general help between people and household tasks, sewing buttons on, and 61 villagers use it at the moment. Retirement age is increasing. You know, this is a really important thing. And events like the Neighbourhood Plan, bringing people together to work together on projects, can only help strengthen this. So that was a really intensive morning, and we've got blasted through all of that, but we have a record of all of them, and it'd be great to spend more time looking at that. In the afternoon, after lunch, we got our wellies on, and we went out to see a lot of the things that we've been told about. Banky Field, and the lower plats that separates it in this footpath, and how difficult it can be. Here are the issues, that the rain had fallen, and that is what your footpath is. Shocking, this, you know, it's revealing the old brickwork, and it's nice and smooth for the cars though, isn't it? You know, it's the other way around. East Sussex County Council, I've got zero budget for maintenance. How do we get this fixed? Well, you know, these aren't easy. Certain times of the year, paths become inaccessible. Oh, the government's filling in potholes for cars, but it's not filling in, you know, the pavements perhaps need the priority here. And we've been writing down these little signs and tying them up. Some people may have seen these around the village. We've done a little fly posters, wanted paved paths, and we've got the website address on the bottom. So if you see one of those, it's the team here to blame. The footpath continues over and up. And those who are cycling or less mobile, you know, these are really difficult places to use. And when you're on the top here, you can see right down to the church. So that landscape starts to reveal itself. This has planning permission, but they're struggling to get a developer on board. So you've got a different sort of problem here. It's got permission, but it hasn't got a developer. There's another site, it's got a developer, but not got permission. So there's, you know, strange things here. That this is a really well-connected site. You can see the village laid out below. You know, you can imagine that lit in the evening, good pedestrian routes right down are really needed to connect this site back in. And this is not how to encourage walking and cycling. You know, gates with difficult to get prams around, and there are better ways to do it. The rain had come down by now, but they stuck with it, and they looked at this play area, Farthing Hill Playground, needs upgrading. A sign was left on there, and the lady saw the sign. She came in this morning, said, absolutely does not need upgrading, needs removing, she said. She lives nearby. And she feels that she lives in one of these houses. It gets vandalised, the teenagers hang out. It's the wrong place for a playground. We want, if you're going to build a new one, it shouldn't be here. So that was an interesting point. She lives nearby. She'd rather investment be made in the playground where we are here, down in the middle. So that was a good debate this morning. And the Scout Hut here, do not enter. They get up to all sorts, I believe, in there. The Scout Hut, really well used at the end of the road. The route comes around, and you're linking back now into the village. And Mike lost his temper at this point and kicked the bin in. We couldn't work out the bin had got damaged. Is vandalism, is it? Or is a lorry backed into it? But either way, this whole area was a sort of interesting mix of slightly down at hill, shabby, interesting mix with the Scout Hut, the industrial areas. But before you know it, you're connecting back out down into the village square. So you've got the car park to the Bell and Newington Court. But this does connect all the way back round. And pedestrian access to the car park, can you get that through here? And then you're out into this square, which we've heard from Liz and others as well, it's too much clutter. There's proliferation of signage going on. The Bell stuck its own quirky signs out. You've got your telephone box wrapped in adverts for tonight. The Duke of York Hotel, full stop, painted on. And the shop. And there's a lot going on, perhaps too much. And I think it's a great meeting place. And you're very lucky to have a square. Most villages in this part of the world have a green, so it's unusual. Village squares aren't a typical thing in this part of Kent and East Sussex. But you've got one, but it's become a car park. So we need to perhaps think about that. Better signs, not more signs. So that's the afternoon. We came back. We had another group out to Stonegate with Sophie. And the Stonegate team, it's Jane, wasn't it, who was with you? Jane put these signs up, advertising tonight. We looked at the quarry, and could that be redeveloped? And these were areas that had been picked up in the work in January. And the church on a grey day, which has got amazing landscape around it. And Stonegate, please drive carefully. We think this was school traffic. Maybe it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But this field, this paddock that someone in the earlier work had said could be developed. You know, you can see it does provide a very green welcome as you come in there. And that's the site on that side. So So this field, you know, the signs are out there in the rain, and that's the view looking in. So Stonegate Station, an important commuter one, and Sophie and Jane put a sign up there about the meeting tonight. No sooner it had been tied up than a gentleman came along and read it, which is great. Are you here tonight, sir? It didn't work then, never mind. But someone recognises him, and you know, a lot of people going in and out of that. We'll be leaving by the station tomorrow. It's detached from Stonegate Village, but it's still in your parish and it matters. And Cottenden Road by the Village Hall as you head out here, consultation sign for that. So we looked at traffic as well. This is Ticehurst, the parked cars, vehicles down the middle of the road. There's a view that this is a problem, but actually if you think you've got something coming towards you, you might slow down a little bit. You know, no sight line, does that mean you drive more carefully? And here's Church St Mary's Lane as well, forced into the middle, but parking on the pavements again, and this is a real problem, you know. And implicit in this is from the driver is, I'm going to block the less important area. I'm going to keep the important bit clear, the road, and I'll block the pavement because it doesn't really matter. And that sort of systemic issue is that walking and getting using the pavements isn't that important around here when it is. So can we have, in London, that's illegal. In the rest of the country, it's advised against, but it's not illegal. However, driving on the pavement is illegal around the country. So unless these cars were lifted into place by a crane, something has been done that shouldn't have been done. And you do have narrow lanes, but the pavements matter. And the reason people aren't walking and cycling or walking, the reason they're not walking is because of this. So they get in their car and they drive, and the system, the cycle continues that we have more cars on the road. So we're not saying we're going to get rid of the car. It's about where it's parked and how it's used. And that really matters. So we came back in the room with our muddy boots, and we had visitors, the youngsters in the room as well, and cups of tea were drunk, and they got busy drawing what they'd seen. And the plans were, tracing paper was out and working out the route that was taken. And another group looked at the centre, and you can see the square picked out and how that connects together. Looking at access and movement issues, and the sites that could be seen as developed. So this was one of the plans that emerged yesterday. It was a scribbly plan with the sense of connection down there between the junction where the toll house is and also just where we are here out towards Flimwell. Parking issues, slowing down the traffic before it reaches the centre. Lanes should feel like lanes and be dominated by pedestrians, you know. Make St Mary's Lane, that little cut through, feel much more friendly to people walking up and down it. The junction outside the Village Hall needs improvement to get better pedestrian access. Banky Field and all weather routes are needed. So last night we sort of redid this plan a little bit neater. The square sits in the middle, and this slower speed zone should be from this junction right through to that one. And the yellow area there needs to have its parking looked at, its pay, its materials. So by the time they come through the square, they're already at 20 miles an hour or even lower. You know, it's no good slowing just in the middle. And journey times across the village will be negligible difference, but crossing that road will be made a lot easier. And when you look at the heart of your village here in Ticehurst, you've got this important green space at the churchyard, the sports pitch up here as well. It's like a green bow tie. And in the middle of this is a civic space. There's going to be trees in there as well. So you've got a big green space, a civic, not an urban, a civic rural village square, and a churchyard there. And this connection from the lane that they walk down and down through needs to be made much stronger, much more obvious. So it's not just an east-west movement, but north-south as well. This is an example from Buckinghamshire, and we're working with the traffic engineer that's developed these ideas, and his document is called Safety, Civility and Slower Speeds in a Historic Village. And having looked through this, I felt a lot of this was appropriate to a village like Ticehurst. And he's a really good street designer, Ben Hamilton Bailey, and he's done a lot of innovative work in villages and towns. And you can see here the welcome sign, and what they've done is just widen the edges by putting a different surface colour down. It's actually no wider than before, but the tarmac is now much narrower, and the driver immediately starts to slow down because they're worried they'll bash their wing mirror on something coming towards them. You can still pass one another, but the pedestrians now have a dedicated space, and it works very well. This is a before image, Ivinghoe in Buckinghamshire. This could be bits of Ticehurst. You might recognise the idea that you've got to cross this big junction and there's a bit of pavement and another junction and down. And the cars just whiz straight through. And here, there's a bit of leftover space that is green, there's a bus shop, bus shelter. And afterwards, there's an idea of, you know, you can have a much more continuous route through. This space could have well-drained car parking off-street, you know, relocate the bus shelter. And that way, you can see there's some off-street parking as well. It's still very rural in its approach, but it tidies things up. No yellow lines, no slowdown, no chevrons. Keep it simple. And Ben's done some sketches here around a sweeping bend. And this is, again, the village. There's a church. This could be Stonegate, really. And here, there's what they've done is these little cut pedestrian edges. The pavement's still there. It's just re-tarmacked. It's done in a way that the driver feels they're slowing down. And these little breaks in the middle really psychologically give you places to cross. And it works really well. And it works in a village because it's not full of paint and signs and flashing slowdown. And here's a sweeping bend round. And this is the link up to the front door of their church. There's a little path there. And this is a really lovely, quite radical sweep where that leads you up to the front door there. And cars still run up and down. But here, this property now feels much more connected and the cars are actually secondary to it. And these are simple surface treatments, but it's all about psychology for the driver and the pedestrian and rebalancing it. And this could be where we are now. This is the village hall or the sort of civic building in Ivanhoe, Buckinghamshire. There's the front door and there's a link through. And again, same sort of treatment, stripping things back, keeping it simple. Cars will still run through here, but it's a very different way of thinking. And people have told us getting to the front door here is tricky sometimes, a lot of the time. And I think these last two illustrate what you can do with just simple treatments. These aren't expensive, but they'll have to be done by the county, working with your neighbourhood plan group. But these are light touch, rural, traffic calming in rural areas is emerging now as the things that you do in towns and cities don't necessarily work in a village, but this sort of thing is starting to prove that it does. And then finally here, you've got the church, and this is the junction space in Ivanhoe, in a way a little bit like the Stonegate Junction, where the lanes all come together, five lanes coming together in the middle, and a big sea of tarmac, people sort of crossing as and when they can. And what they've done here is give a very direct route from the church through to this side of the village. It's not a roundabout. There's no giveaways. Everyone gives way to everybody else. The speeds come right down. We've got some off-street parking, and this space is a real sort of heart of the village. And it could have artwork printed in it or little bits of text as well that really set it out. But no one whizzes through there anymore. Previously, it was priority in one direction where they'd come sweeping round and everyone would give way on the other side. So these sorts of things are really getting ideas, people thinking about how villages can work. So that's a slight detour into traffic and the street design in Buckinghamshire. But what we did in the sites yesterday was look at these development sites. This one was deferred, its decision this morning by Rother District Council around Hillbury. They decided not to make a decision on that, prevarication, sitting on the fence as it were, but maybe they just want more information. Banky Field has permission. This is Hebditch. There's an appeal decision pending. And this was refused permission, the Ryden Homes site. And other little ones were noted as well as coming forward. Ryden Sinchur site, a suitable location. People felt that worked. Was disappointed, didn't get permission in a way. Farthing Hill Playground, we know that there's a challenge that is better equipment needed. And the car park behind the Bell, improvements to that as well, which we looked at. And Stonegate. Traffic, better parking control. We've just seen an example of how you might do that. And then finally, yesterday afternoon, this work that came out of Stonegate, which I suppose is the most contentious bit of we've done so far, the January plan was challenged and reviewed. And a lot of these ideas up here were considered inappropriate, not right. And this site here was felt it would not be developed. And the idea that Stonegate does not have the services and the infrastructure, the shops and so on that Ticehurst has, and it shouldn't really have housing. That was a general feeling that was put forward. So this amazing landscape here in the ridge and these views out were well understood as being important. There's this old quarry site that's got a lorry park in it at the moment. Could that be redeveloped? How would that all fit together? And here in the middle, this crossroads that might have some sort of address treatment there. But the message is yesterday afternoon, Stonegate does not want large-scale development, does not want any development. It was, you know, one message, you can't take it. Needs to preserve the rural setting, and pressure on infrastructure has got to be considered. Cottenham Road, the views are really important, the road's narrow with speed and traffic, and so on. So that was all day yesterday, okay? And people left, and people came in the evening to look at the work, and our team stayed up late drawing stuff and putting things together. And the beginning of this morning, we did a recap of everything, and then we agreed the afternoon work. So that was our messages. And the key task in the morning was to look at these settlements and start writing planning policy based on everything that we've heard. So it really was quite an important morning to say, right, what are the planning policies for your neighbourhood plan? When you look at Flimwell, the themes that were emerging were about innovation, about enterprise, about working, about making, about architecture, about teaching, parish gateway, the A21, it's your shop window, is it? You know, things are going on there, the Steve Johnson's project and the Woodland Enterprise Centre, really quite exciting. And we haven't had many people from Flimwell in throughout the 2 days, but we've got to re-engage with them and work out, are you the innovative, creative part of the parish? You know, that could be their identity. Ticehurst, mixed use, mixed community. It's got shops, pharmacy, pubs. It's got an East London trendy pub in the Bell that's, you know, people like or dislike. But it's right in the heart. It's got the shop. It's got this mixed community, and people really enjoy the fact it's got people from different walks of life and different backgrounds there. And that's why traffic calming and the public space really matters, because your civic space should be where that mixed community mixes and meets one another, has events, and actually is the welcoming heart of the village. So that was the theme there about mix and affordability. The Stonegate theme, it was about preservation. It was about very little change there. Walking routes to the station. A lady came in this afternoon and said, people say, oh, you can walk to the station. You really can't. It's very hard to do. So maybe some traffic changes ideas about a green route down, if you can get that in, would help. But it's about that sense of, in a way, isolation or a sense of detachment, I think it is, really. I'm trying to think of the right word. But they're a place apart, really, down there. And so we're trying to develop themes for them, but also how that whole parish can be glued together, because it's your neighbourhood plans for everybody. There's not three neighbourhood plans here, and we want to avoid that. So in the morning, we had these plans laid out, and we asked people to look at this, to start to test them in more detail, and concerns about location and type and potential and Stonegate and discussion about how to manage and implement change in a positive way. And brother and sister turned up. They've lived in the village 80 years or 160 years combined. And Mike talked to them. It was great. He sat down for a good hour and talked through all of this and how it works. They were really interested in the village square, but they left interested in everything. And amazing local knowledge there. And this group looked at Flimwell on the computer, checking what Steve Johnson was saying about it and how Flimwell could change. So we were really revisiting the work from yesterday and how the bird park could influence design and development across the whole parish. You know, the idea of getting away from standard house types and boring boxes, well, Flimwell might have the answers for what modern architecture, good modern architecture in a village should look like for the 21st century. So the task we gave them this morning was to write 5 policy headings for each settlement. Parish-wide policies, where your policies are specific, annotate them, and if you know of projects, add them in too. So that was it, 5 policies, and Stonegate brilliantly wrote us 13 for them. So they are independent, they told us that. Small-scale development to the north, small-scale affordable brownfield in the quarry, possibly, these were potentials, not definites. Attractive views across the south, keeping the place rural, ridges, parking, the cricket pitch, the pavilion to go with that. The village centre need to retain a small commercial site. Should a village shop ever come back, or should the farmers market want a more permanent place to act from or work out of? How you can retain a space for commercial activity. Traffic calming on the gateways, protecting the views. So a terrific list, a balance between preservation and change and the managing that change. Flimwell, we got 8, which is great. These are the headlines for your neighbourhood plan. Village Hall, which might be coming on the corner farm site, we understand. Parish Gateway from the A21. The cricket ground's really well loved and well used. The pavilion's good as well, promoting that, maintaining it. Traffic management, self-build centre of expertise. Self-build is something we heard a lot about the last 2 days. How can you get land to be used to self-build? Well, the expertise might come out of these projects up there. And then Ticehurst draft policies about the village square as a centrepiece of that. Traffic calming, entering the junctions, community group. Could take over the Banky Field one. If developers are not buying into this, they think it's too challenging, it's got permission. How could you get a community right to buy, right to build, and design innovative self-build housing there? That's something we can talk about and come on to. Affordable housing, smaller developments keeping the rural nature, parking management. So 12 great headlines that we can expand upon for your neighbourhood plan. Here in black, these are the plans, the policies that apply parish-wide, you know, the glue that holds everybody together. The footpaths, promoting self-build, developing pedestrian-friendly policies, access to Buell water, and so on. So these are the things that matter to everybody. So we've typed them up, but these are the raw data, as it were. We went through this and got that on a record, and here's a great plan that they produced, trying to link it all together. They used the right coloured felt pens, which is good. So after that, at about 2 o'clock this afternoon, we went out and looked at employment land, and Sophie went to speak to Adam from Altered Images. Lack of commercial property, this is a real tumble-down thing. These are great, and they're making good use of old buildings, but there's more of this. Altered Images, was it photos and digital?
Framing.
Picture framing. But you know, you've got high-tech businesses, low-tech businesses, crafts businesses, artisan businesses, and the opportunity for more commercial development here, we understand, in this sort of place. The working landscape, three-leg cross, they didn't want to get left out, so Antonio went up with Anne, this narrow lane that runs in and out, and Manuel's Fruit Farm, the first pick-your-own in the country. A really popular character, David, he's been with us throughout this project, the Bull, popular with the locals and the visitors alike. This fantastic countryside that opens up the moment you get around the back. It rolls down and you get the long and short distance views, and it's just behind where we are. And you know, that's very special, and no one's going to argue that that's got to be protected. You have Area of Outstanding Natural Beauty Protection, which is nationally designated. How can your neighbourhood plan dovetail with that and not double up? Working community farm as well, and cattle, sheep, chickens. We've got muddy these past few days. We started to look at architecture. The former cottages for doctors and nurses, now private residential, that's changed over time. 17th century house and a new house. Have we got the labels the right way around on those, by the way?
Yeah.
Just checking. You know, do we want to just copy, or do we want to innovate? And how can you innovate with reference to the past? So Anne's got a whole load of knowledge about this as well. Restored house here, and Oast house as well. And one of the last standing hot barns in the country, apparently. And once upon a time, this house was removed brick by brick and rebuilt further up the hill, Van told us. So all of this architecture and these buildings are a rich legacy that the neighbourhood plan needs to learn from. And if we can marry that learning from the past with the innovation that comes out of Flimwell, you've got a fantastic future if you can get the housing to learn from that. And that's a challenge to do it. And Chris from Ryden Homes is listening in at the back here. Mm-hmm. He's just nodded. So that took us to about 4 o'clock this afternoon. And what we've tried to do then is bring all of this work together into some sort of strategy plan. So these are all draft, all ideas. And what we first did was draw on all the ancient woodland that you have from the AOMB map. And here in the green, lime green colour, and it runs in a very interesting pattern, these north-south narrow stands of trees fitting with the topography. Here that you've got these catchment areas, as it were, around the three settlements, big banks of ancient woodland around Flimwell. It gets a little bit more sparse around the middle, but that's the landscape setting and the topography that comes with it. Over the top of this, we've put in all the historic farmsteads that the AOMB office have identified. And you've got measles here. It's a fantastic, rich collection of small properties out in the countryside. That's your working legacy, your historic working parish. And you can see that the clustering of them around Stonegate and so on, around the edge. There were some dots in Buell Water, which went under when it was built. But we need to recognise that as well. And one of the suggestions in the presentations yesterday morning was if many of these farmsteads could just build one or two very small cottage-type developments, you can hit your target without anybody really noticing. It's not one big development. It's a very scattered approach to development. That's something we need to address and see how that could work. Not necessarily the historic ones, but some of the working ones. Development patterns. So we've looked at these, and these drawings that Antonio produced are really good because they show just the format, the layout of the housing. This is Flimwell. The A21 runs through here. There's a gap here. And this gap, it was safeguarded by East Sussex County Council many years ago for when the dual carriageway, which has not yet been built, would go through in a straight line. So that explains where that gap is there. The church is down here, and there's a definite east and west issue here. So we're over that, we've put this little strategy plan. It captures the talk from these last few days about the Woodland Enterprise Centre, with activity there, and over the road, all being well, there could be a brilliant companion to this. Innovation, teaching, a university from London with an outreach, how to make woodland really productive and work. And this is ancient woodland area where they'll locate themselves deep within, sensitively. You've got your junction here, which needs better pedestrian crossings to tie east and west together. The church is just out here, important landmark, St. Augustine's, I think, is that right? And that, with the Woodland Centre on its doorstep, will start to feel part of the parish again. It feels a little bit out there, leaning towards Hawkhurst. And that's your boundary. That's Kent. Boo, over there. Bring it in, this side. And here, this sort of green crescent we've shown is that gap. There's a gap down the hill that people want to protect. Flimwell, it's already started to spill out a little bit, and people are anxious that it doesn't carry on. So the idea that there's you are leaving Flimwell, and you then go down to the cherry tree and arrive in Ticehurst. The cricket pitch is sitting there, very importantly, and possibly a new village hall through the development at Corner House. So that strategy plan captures quite an exciting future for Flimwell, and we can build around that as well. Ticehurst, different pattern. You can see the square. It stands out very well in the middle. And we've got Springfield on the back edge here, and it, lower density, larger plots on the edges here. Very tight, very rural, but still high density. It's heart to your village. This is a 60 to the hectare. You know, this is not suburbia, it's a high density centre. These are the big challenges that face you right now. The development sites, Hilbury, Hebditch, Bankey Field, Orchard Farm, Singhurst refused permission, and one was nominated today, a potential infill that many years ago people had tried. So they're all on the edges, they're all sort of moving in. Fairly well distributed, but quite large, and the quality of these and how they connect is really going to matter. That's gone to appeal, that's been deferred, that's got permission. Your neighbourhood plan will have to accommodate these, probably. It's too late now to perhaps influence some of these on the edge. They're in the pipeline. Your plan needs to think about how it will work with these, and maybe smaller infill can attach. So the plan that tries to bring this together, you can see them still on there, but you've got this fantastic, we've called it the square to the school. We've got the school up here, but this green arc around the top of Bankey Field, down to this lane, past the Scout Hut, which is there, down to your new square in the middle, that link could be really, really important to connect people and allow them to walk without having to, you know, run the traffic down that side. These links down are really important. If these sites are to be developed, how they connect back to the village so that people will walk and use the shops and the pubs and come into the middle. If people have to feel they need to get in their car, they could go anywhere. And you want these people, if they are to be living in these sites, to be patrons of your shops and services and the pharmacy and everything else. Otherwise, what's the point? You know, you'd just be a commuter settlement. So the pedestrian links that can be achieved to the heart of your village really matter. We need to keep these edges in, the green crescent, there's the cherry tree on that edge, and the ponds and the woodland here, and the Ride and Home site could open up and improve that footpath link through and up to the school. So things do seem to work, but there's anxiety about the quality and the speed of this delivery. And the civic space in the middle, we've got these two green places, and the quote that was given to us yesterday was about rediscovering this. You know, it's been lost, and that's how it used to look, and rediscover this. And it's not just a car park, people should get in and use the services. And the quote we were given was, give the village a beating heart to keep it alive for the future. And it's a really good metaphor that space is not for cars, it's for everybody. And how can you tie the green spaces north and south and these developments that may or may not happen here to make that work? And finally, we got onto Stonegate and looked at that development pattern, very, very different. These lanes that come down from these outlying farmsteads and this little junction space, which is really intimate, and how that fits together. The church is down here and the school. And overlaid on this is this idea of green protection. We've listened to people from Stonegate. These really important green gaps that look south, and this idea of a green arc, protection from the ponds and the woodlands here near the village hall. If you take a line through the church and back round, this is a sort of green hand around the south of Stonegate, looking after it, and it would not be developed around here. You've got the green space behind the school as well. That's your welcome to Stonegate sign, and this area is very special. To the north, you've got your cricket pitch, and round through here, past the allotments and around, and that's the quarry site. You know, the little pink dot on the quarry, what would you put there, if anything? A lorry park does not seem to me to be a good long-term solution for Stonegate. It could be something, we don't know what. How do we develop that? And we've also got the ridge line here, and views from this direction are important, so we need to be aware of that. Now, if, and this is an if you got developing Stonegate, the only way you could potentially do it is to, you've got allotments here as well, so I'm not suggesting you build on them and lose them, but if you got your new cricket pavilion there, you might get a little edge of housing around the top here that then has secures a green edge that links, and you might get a route, a pedestrian route through, and you get, on the count there, there's about 10 to 15 houses tops, and that's the only place we think they would fit. But there has been this debate over the last 2 days about should Stonegate have nothing and Ticehurst have everything, or can we share it a little bit more evenly across? It's a very hard one in Stonegate, and this is an idea to be shot down, so we're putting it out there. Here in the middle, we've got yellow space. It might be like that Ivanhoe Junction, where that junction has a real decorative but safe feel in the middle. It's not just a giveaway, but something special that really marks the middle of this village. So that's a strategy plan that can be challenged as we move forward. So what next? I'm coming to the end now, so you'll be okay. What you've got after 2 days and the work in January that preceded it, you've got a fantastic set of ingredients that have come from you about your neighbourhood plan. And there's a clear sense of direction on the policies now. We know what we need to write. We know what research you might need to do to fill in some gaps and what you need to look at. And I think the relationship between these settlements is better understood. Certainly we feel we know where they're going. I think they've got a very different identity, all of them. They complement each other very well. Ticehurst is clearly the boss. It's in the middle. Cheer. No? Okay. Stonegate's independent and different down the bottom there. And Flimwell could be a fantastic centre of innovation. I've said it before, but I think what's going on up there is quite special. And you need to get the ideas there cascading across the rest of the parish. You know, that work shouldn't be just held in isolation up there. So a further testing of these ideas. These are ideas. They've got to be refined. Nothing you've seen tonight is final. But if you like it, we want to hear. If you don't, we want to hear. And it's vital to get the planners from Rother District Council involved in this. Is there anyone from Rother District Council here tonight? No. They've been invited, he sent his apologies, but it's really important because it's still your plan in italics, but the district council, where we've worked elsewhere, when you have a supportive district or borough council, it makes life a lot easier pushing it through the system. So they need to say, be shown this work, say, these are our ideas, how can you help us do it? So that's important for the next steps. We need to look again at beyond these current housing sites, thinking well into the future. You know, what happens after Banky Field and these other sites, if they win on appeal and if Hillbury does get built on, that won't be it. Things will carry on. How can you look at it? And just in the last few weeks, advice in the National Planning Policy Guidance has said neighbourhood planning needs to look for reserve sites. It needs to think beyond. Really, it's up to you to do it. And what's emerged today and yesterday, small-scale sites of 2 to 3 units is the way forward, not large fields being built on in large numbers. So you can actively search them out. You can work with landowners and others to actively say you can make it work. Now, Rother have a strange rule that anything under 6 doesn't count towards housing targets. Your neighbourhood plan can rewrite that. I would have every confidence that if you find 15 small sites of 2 to 3, that's a big development of housing overall, but it's on your terms. So work with Rother, challenge Rother's position, but think beyond the current situation. So, our final slide, it's been really intensive, it's been highly thought-provoking, and there's been energy and enthusiasm from everyone we've met. So, from behalf of the team, Sophie, Antonio, myself, and the Parish Council, a big thank you to everyone that's got involved. Thank you. We're happy to take questions, and if people just want to look at the work on the wall, then you can do that as well. Yes, there's a microphone going around as well.
I've got three questions. For those of us on outlying farmsteads, when we come into the village shop, are we going to retain some short-term parking? I mean, I know the real problem. We all feel the real problem is Ticehurst Motors there, taking up loads of the parking with their cars for sale. But we're going to retain some short-term parking in the centre of the village, people popping in and out of the shops.
I'll answer that one first, and you do the next two. Yes, is the short answer. The challenge is to get the right amount and not dominate that space. And short-term parking will be, and for disabled and others, will be needed. A lot of places we work, a lot of businesses have often misunderstood how many customers come from the parking outside the door. And actually, you've got a lot going on in Ticehurst. And parking the car once, for those who are a bit more able to walk to the pharmacy, walk to the Greedy Goat, maybe go pop into the Bell to meet someone, parking once elsewhere, they don't need to be in the square necessarily. So he's getting the parking in the square for those that really need it, and parking elsewhere, and there is a car park, a short walk and a lit path, trying to get that used more effectively and more efficiently. So it's about the balance, but there's no plan to ban the cars from the middle. It's getting the balance right. And it might be trialled. A good way to do this is to trial it over a period of a week or two and see how the anticipated problems may not arise. So, you know, there's no hard and fast rule to it, but that's the answer to number one.
Can I just follow up on that? It hasn't really answered the question, because Ticehurst Motors takes up half that parking space, if it is parking space, permanently, which is unattractive. I mean, just having Ticehurst Motors there is unattractive. But secondly, it'd be very nice to reclaim that as a village square.
Absolutely, yeah.
Perhaps with one of your sort of smart road layouts. Yeah, so in Battle, for example, they've got a sort of cobbled area that you don't...
The working group that Liz is on is... Ticehurst Motors is a debate about who owns what on the line on the ground, but that is being understood and being worked on. So it's a good point, but it's being addressed, yeah. A line of Suzuki Jimneys is not necessarily Ticehurst's quality. Sorry, you've got two more, sir. Yeah.
So the next thing is about lorries. Yeah. I mean, we're trying to calm down the British. In fact, one of your images up there was something I suggested to the highways, to punctuate the two ends of the British at this juncture in a Vineyard Lane.
Yeah.
So you could take out the little grey, the green, and put a small sort of painted mini roundabout on.
Yeah.
And they were just so rude. They kind of, yeah, we take your ideas on board. Not.
Okay, I'll answer
We also do need to still keep lorries coming in. I mean, I know it's meant to be an evil thing, but we do have to send grain out, we do have to bring fertiliser in, we do have industry, and we've got a couple of companies here, there's one in Flimwell, which is a very successful goal to do all the lorry recovery from all over Europe.
Yeah.
There's a smaller one of his ex-employees, or two of his ex-employees, are setting up their small one. I see their recovery lorry changing part there. We do have to have employment in Ticehurst, otherwise we're going to relocate to Stonegate Station.
Quick answer, the Buckinghamshire examples, what's been really good about these is that it redresses the surface, but larger vehicles, agricultural vehicles, this is why it's innovative about rural traffic calming, they still move through. They've still got the width they need, they can still turn, but psychologically, everyday smaller vehicles have a narrower carriageway. When a large vehicle comes through, it overruns those coloured strips. And pedestrians do have to take a step back at that point, but everything's moving through slowly. But at no point would you block the larger vehicles. But what you do is deter high-speed movement of those larger vehicles by redressing the streets like that. So I think there's techniques at either end that you've pointed out could really work and get the pedestrian priority, but not prevent the agricultural and industrial vehicles.
Thank you. And the third question is, one of the things you put up there, which is one of the things I was very in favour of, is limiting the size of the developments. We've got Bankley Field, which is like almost 40 houses. We've got the meadow at just down the road here on the left. They're trying to put in 32 houses. I mean, the one that really worked nicely is Cross Lane Gardens, 20 bungalows. Much smaller development, less bedrooms.
Yeah.
If we look in terms of number of bedrooms in the development, rather than perhaps the number of houses in the development, can we bring something in here? Do we have the right to bring something in here at this stage, which says, yes, we're looking for developments, but say limiting it to 15, 16 houses?
You can do that. The challenge with that is that a lot of developers will say, well, we're not going to be able to provide any affordable as part of this because it's too small. By the time you bought the land and the infrastructure and the drainage and all of that, it becomes less viable. So there are tipping points where you might not get certain additional benefits, but it's not at all impossible. And there are neighbourhood plans around the country, one in Cheshire, which is a good example, where they, very different, they were facing 300 homes on the edge in one big block, and they found 10 sites for 30 houses distributed elsewhere, and that one went all the way to the High Court, with the house builder who had 300, he was absolutely livid when he realised that they'd come up with an alternative. But with a few days to go before the hearing, on legal advice, they withdrew their appeal because they were told they'd lose. Their neighbourhood plan in that instance now has the same number of homes, but in a different distribution that they felt worked better. What they perhaps aren't getting there are necessarily uplifts in terms of a big chunk of affordable and other things, but they felt on balance that was a better way forward. So the scale of development and the speed of development is definitely something you should can and should address through your plan.
Is that something that the audience here is more happy with? I mean, we've seen the tremendous protests. We've had this room completely full of people against Bankley Field, against There'll be gardens, meadow. We've seen that we're completely full against people who are, with people against fetishes. Is that what the people here would like, or is it me?
The problem we have is that the decisions are already probably out of our hands.
On those particular sites,
that is 70 to 100 houses.
Yeah.
Boom, gone. We have no say over it.
But
we do. We've got an extra month now, haven't we, before the goddess is again?
You won't have a neighbourhood plan in a month. We've done a lot in 2 days, but you're asking a lot in a month.
Yes.
No, there is a process to get through, and I think those sites that are in the planning system now, you know, they will be resolved in their own way. What this can do is start to understand what you want to do next, and these smaller sites, this plan is for the next 10, 15, 20 years. So it's a long-term thing, and if you get the right mix, you will avoid a repeat of Hilbury and Hibditch. That's the best you can get from that. But you can also influence the way some of those sites connect back, hopefully, if they do get refused and they try again. So,
We'll be optimistic.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Right. Well, Pauline, yes.
And how do we get the highways on our side? Because it must be more expensive to do two turns.
Yes, it is.
And they don't like change and looking at things differently. It's wonderful.
Pauline's question was, how do you get highways on board? And the gentleman at the back said that highways are just, you know, you can't do it. Well, that's why Buckinghamshire and Ben's work, who's developed that's good, because he's always working with county councils, is essentially retraining highway engineers. And there's a generation of highway engineers that, you know, aren't very good at understanding the change that's happened. So those schemes are actually relatively cheap. The roads are going to have to be resurfaced at some point anyway. When that is, I don't know. But at that point, they can resurface them like that. It's not actually additional cash in that respect. And the reduced speeds will not cause as much damage. The verges won't be overrun in the way they're getting damaged at the moment. Reduced speeds means fewer collisions, and there's an impact on costs and so on. Speed cameras and flashing signs aren't needed. That costs money. It's actually cheaper. But you've got to say, this is the system you need. This is how you need to approach it. So, you've got to get East Sussex County Council to say, look, this is what Ticehurst wants, and when you next redo the roads around here, let's do them like this. So there's ways to do it, and these developments might chip in and pay a little bit towards that type of work, but they aren't massively expensive, and that's the best thing about them. But they work. They also look good. So it's win-win, really, for everything. Gentlemen there.
Yes, and I think it's I'm really in favour of what we're trying to achieve. But I do think there's a considerable problem about funding. We're just touching on it now. And, you know, we can't even get the potholes filled in that we're getting in the roads, and the roads are in an appalling condition. So the aspirations we have of creating this wonderful village, which I hope will happen, but the funding is reality, is going to be incredibly difficult. Now, we touched on it yesterday where Ryan have offered possibly that they will fund certain things or help with the village. We need to go to developers, but we're a bit late for these schemes now because they're all part of 106 agreements and being determined, I would think. So where do we go? You know, the funding is the issue here.
It is.
Lovely ideas, but really, in reality, how are they going to be achieved financially?
It does come down to money, and it's important that that's not forgotten.
I would say rather than important.
Sorry?
I would say critical rather than important.
Critical, yeah. Without it, it won't happen, so it is critical, yeah. But if we began this process with the current budgets, we'd have gone home yesterday. So we've got to be ambitious and bold and say, you know, if money was no object, what would we do? And actually put that on the wall as the target. This is where Ticehurst Parish should be heading. And then you work hard to pull the funding in as and when you can. And it'll be a little bit here, a little bit there, and you sort of pool that resource. But if you don't have the bigger picture, it's going to be really hard to pull in funding. So, apologies if it is to, you know, we've got to try, haven't we? But we've got at the same time, money's going to be hard to come by. And if they can't fill in potholes, they can't do that. But at least there's something now to pin on the wall and say that's where we're going. Money is critical, not just important. David at the front and then Lee.
While we've got the number of houses that are imposed upon us, for which we are not really able to do a great deal from our small, say, scale here. And yet, numbers of houses that are fewer than six are not counted towards these, it's very difficult to think how we can have dispersed small hamlets, because they're not going, if we're going to have four houses here and three houses there, we're still having these large numbers of houses imposed upon us.
David's questions about that threshold of six. Well, I'm suggesting that your neighbourhood plan rewrites that. You know, you've got to work with Rother, but I think it's an absolutely daft rule. Every house counts should be the mantra. You know, and by saying it, those under six don't count. What is that? Makes no sense.
Is it just a Rother policy?
It's not national.
The six. Anything below six doesn't count.
I've not heard of it until I've worked
here.
I can only assume it.
You need to fight it from here.
Teresa's got some good feedback for today.
Yeah, Teresa, you might want to come in on that.
Yeah, I read a new neighbourhood plan that actually has been agreed by Rother. And that's and they were asked to do 35 houses. Their plan shows about 18 over five sites. It doesn't set any, it doesn't stipulate exactly enough, and it's been part of the plan.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's their neighbourhood plan for the future to be phased in.
Yeah.
So I think it's about we don't accept what we're saying.
That's encouraging that in Rother they've done it. So there you go. So that rule can be challenged and has been challenged, and I think it would be only reasonable to be to do the same. Lady Valley.
We said there's two things. In response to sort of the funding issue, I mean, if we are going to sort of have to have some developments in the future, etc., is there a way of bringing that into, the, you know, making it sort of compulsory that developments also add the extra sort of pathways or whatever it is that's needed, so that should then take some of the cost?
Yeah, it would do. And I think that, in a way, is linked to the question at the beginning about the scale of housing. There is an efficiency in a larger site. The developer will make more profit by having a larger site where they can roll the drains out and build 15, 20, 30 houses, 50 houses in one go. And that will allow them to offer more, as it were, in terms of community benefits, paying for this, paying for that. If you do go for small clusters of two or three, that's squeezed right down. So these are sort of swings and roundabouts on that. But yes, there will be linkages between the houses built and contributions. Community Infrastructure Levy, CIL, C-I-L, is 15% goes to communities, which is essentially a roof tax. It's a set amount of money per square meterage built, and that's coming in Rother. But villages that have, or parishes that have a neighbourhood plan take 25% of that money. So there's more money to be had if you get a plan in place. So developers will be asked to contribute CIL, Community Infrastructure Levy. There's also Section 106 money, which is a financial agreement to maybe pay for bits here and there. The challenge with the neighbourhood plan is keeping it in the parish, because Rother have got libraries to pay for in other parts of the district, and they want money being taken out. So the CIL bit helps keep it in. So that's, funding isn't easy, but there's mechanisms there. But yeah, they'd be asked to pay for the impact that they bring with them. But the only other thing I say on that is, that sounds like all housing is negative and brings nothing but problems. They've got to pay their way. But you know, you've got shops and services, and I'm optimistic that good architecture is new friends and neighbours. You know, these aren't incomers that are commuting. It's how villages stay alive. So they will bring potential problems in terms of traffic impact and other things, but they're going to bring new customers and new people to keep the village going. So they bring both things with them. No, it's a complex thing, funding. But yes, that's the sort of issue, and it came up in the top 10 challenges. We've got, you know, on record, health service is one of the top five, top three. And you need to make the linkage between funding to that if the village grows. What I'd caution is, a lot of people say, we don't have the infrastructure, we can't have the houses. So they're linking the fact they don't have the infrastructure to what they're full up. You know, and Tysus has been around 1,000 years or more, and in 2016, you're full up. Really? You know? That's a real coincidence, really. So you
infrastructure comes first, and then...
No, not necessarily. And that's the challenge, is that if you decide that you're full up until the infrastructure's sorted, when someone does pay for the better drains, better sewage, whatever, then suddenly that objection to housing is gone. So if you don't want new housing on certain sites, build a holistic set of reasons why that site is no good, but somewhere else is better. But infrastructure does not necessarily have to come first. It's a sort of incremental, they'll build. They can't pay for the infrastructure until they've sold the houses because they don't have the money, you know. So there has to be a give and take on that, but you need to peg it so that things don't grow out of hand. That's the thing. We worked in Kent a few years ago when they said, we can't have any more housing, it's drought conditions. We've got standpipes in the streets, you know, where tankers were coming down from Northumberland, we've got no, it was disaster. What, 12 months later, they were flooded, you know? So then now they couldn't build because of flood. So they were all the time they were saying, we can't have new housing for one or another reason, but there's always a way around that technically, eventually. So try and create a picture about the sort of place you want to be and how development will contribute positively to that, rather than saying, you know, we can't grow. Yes, lady.
Could there be, fourth on the list, I think, for all the villages was better broadband.
Yes, yeah.
And being rural, it's going to be years before it gets... Is there some sort of trade-off or bargaining position that we could...
Well, somebody told us that it has arrived.
It has in Tyson, yeah.
It may have arrived in the village, but
in Tyson.
Right.
But if we're half a mile down the farm track, I can't even watch iPlayer without it buffering every few seconds.
Have you subscribed to superfast broadband yet, though?
Well,
you have to change your account. You have to upgrade your account.
We can't get it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because we're
too far off the sort of... The lady is talking about iPlayer. Great, everyone wants to watch a bit of iPlayer. But economically and development-wise, broadband for small businesses is critical. And the government is aware of this. And BT were given this big amount of money, which they seem to have spent on buying football match rights, it would seem, rather than doing what they were meant to do. Apparently they can't afford to do the broadband, but they can afford to screen that. So there is a problem in rolling it out quick enough, and it's not just about a sort of luxury thing at all. It's actually really important, and while we're doing some work near Maidstone, there's a digital photography place. They scan legal documents from London. They scan them all and then archive them so that they can scrap the paper copies and everything can be storage in London's, you know, astronomically expensive. They're in an old apple packing factory in Lewes, and they're about 200 metres from the exchange, and their broadband is super quick. And they said if that was not there, we wouldn't have a business. They employ 20 people. There's a lot of piece rate work from the people that work part-time. Fantastic. And it's all down to that. And that's why it's important. So it's come up a lot, and we need to think about how plans can address it. Steve.
So, Richard, I want to make a kind of publicity bid.
He's good at this. Does it a lot?
A couple of things.
Go and stand where...
There's a position statement on the board over there from Southern Water. I could ask them to come and talk to us about it over these few days, and they weren't able to come, but they've given a position statement which, frankly, is a good example of what I call corporate crap speak. but in there's one or two little gems which basically say we have to kind of consider the neighbourhood plan in our longer term strategies. The other example I've got is East Sussex and the highways. We've had a comment with highways about traffic calming or something, and they said, in effect, their general view is it a good idea? But more importantly, does it have demonstrably support of the community? And what I'm saying really is that a whole host of these little examples will be much stronger with the neighbourhood plan if we get it through with a big vote and a big majority. We will then use that to say, this is a priority, and clearly a priority from the community, that these things are needed. So it does give the parish council a lot of muscle if we get this neighbourhood plan through with a big majority, not just a sort of 10% turnout and we get 8 out of 10 voters voting for it. But if we get 90% turnout across the whole community, and we get 90% of those people supporting it, that is really powerful. Really powerful, and that's when money will come, not all at once, but it'll be come because we've got that argument. It's not just a handful of people saying this is a good idea, it's people saying the community has said clearly in a referendum this is right. So that's why we need the support.
Thank you, Steve. That's true. It's the only part of the planning system that has a referendum at the end of it. So that sense of community support is inherent in the system. And if the plan has ambitious projects about traffic calming or other things, you've got a vote built in. So that is very important that you can use that to apply to funding partners and others as well. So it's a good point Steve made there. We're just on 9 o'clock. So if we draw the night to close, if people want to ask questions of us one-to-one, you know, we'll be tidying up for the next hour or so. Do stick around. Otherwise, if you've got any other announcements...
I was just going to say one thing that you haven't mentioned, which I've asked you, and I think is actually very important in terms of, you know, sort of general interpretation of what the neighbourhood plan could do, was about the pace of development. Because I think one thing that scares a lot of people is that suddenly it's announced that there are going to be 200 houses built in Ticehurst and building starts tomorrow. That actually in the neighbourhood plan one can dictate that any development that takes place in a digestible manner, so that it actually goes bit by bit, so that the community can absorb the change before there's anything more radical happening.
Yeah, that's certainly something, this idea of phased, consistently drip, little bits here and here and there, rather than one big radical change. And the idea that a community can't accept the big cultural, physical shock of a lot of development in one go is a legitimate reason to slow it down and get it right. And that links back to infrastructure coming online with it at the same time. So yeah, that's definitely something to look at.
That doesn't include the existing sites, though, does it?
I think the horse might have bolted there.
Which is the majority.
Yeah, so, you know, you got to think, this is for the next wave, and, you know, making sure that doesn't happen again is the way of thinking.
So the 80-odd units we've got in the planning at the moment, we're going to go...
Maybe or maybe not.
So this is something for the future. I think that should be explained.
Yeah, sorry, just before we finally broke it, next steps, all of this work and what you've seen tonight is going to be sort of packaged up, turned into a short report with more sensible annotations and so on. The next steps we want to try and say, well, now we know what we know, this is what you need to do next and take that forward. But all of this material, most of it's online already, linked across to the Parish Council website. Everything that's come out these last 48 hours will go online as well. And we might set up a sort of more checklist type questionnaire based on the themes that are emerging and what you think. So it's constant engagement. It's not just one big engagement at the end of it. So this will keep moving forward. Steve's going to finish off. I'm going to turn the mic.
Thank you. Oh, right, yeah. So that.
Yeah. Couple.
Well, yes. Hopefully, as long as this looks all right, I will put the whole of this evening's presentation online, so that people who haven't been able to get here will actually be able to listen to what was said rather than just read it.
Online on what site?
Well, I've set up a neighbourhood plan YouTube channel, and we can put anything on that. So it'll. That's where it will be, and on the website there will be a link to the YouTube channel.
Yeah, so we do have an enticesmp.org website, which Rob is developing. We do have a Facebook account, which is Stonegate Tices Flimwell Villages, I think, something like that. And David's producing a YouTube channel as well. So there's lots of opportunities to see the stuff that's been produced as evidence, and then to react to it and give us further comments and so on. Two announcements and then a thank you. On the 21st of April, which I think is a Thursday from memory, is that right, Andy? We're closing the village square for the day to celebrate the Queen's birthday. So there'll be a little event in the village square to try and show how that area can be a communal area and not just a car park. So that's the 21st of April. On the 28th of April, I think, is the village assembly. 26th of April, is the village assembly in here. Well, again, there'll be opportunities to look at the plans and to develop them and moving forward. We've got a whole series of next steps to go through now. This is if we get to a referendum by late spring next year, we'll probably have done well. So it's not going to happen in the next few weeks, but we have a lot of processes to work through, and it's a long process of consultation and review and consultation and review. So, you know, please keep us informed and keep involved. That's what I want to say. What I want to finish with is say that there are at least three heroic people in this room, besides the lot of you sat there. Antonia and Sophie and Richard have performed brilliantly. Back in January, we kept going for about 3.5 days non-stop, and I think they did miraculously. And even Richard looked a little dishevelled by the end of it. But the last couple of days, they were brilliant. They've been carried on. They arrived on Tuesday afternoon. They've been basically non-stop since then. I think we're going to have quite a pint this evening, and then we've got another push-up session in the morning. Sorry. But thank you for all three of you for what you've done, particularly to Richard, who's been splendid. You know exactly what we wanted to do, so great. Thank you very much.